time we are on the verge of a major breakthrough, the universe asks us to release something that we no longer need in our path. This video is about what you are being asked to release and why it's going to be a little harder than you think. The new moon is in Purvabhadrapada, and this is a nakshatra that is associated with technology, organized crime, ritual magic, and the dark night of the soul. The symbol is a cot, a deathbed. The idea of you examining your consciousness right before you enter the abyss, the death, the dark night. The deity is a fire-breathing dragon, fire for purification, and it's on one foot to signify the inner balance that is necessary to wield spiritual power. The element of ritual magic, it's with making deals with the devil, being out in the desert where nobody can see you. So in a situation where nobody's watching and you can do what you want and nobody's there to stop you, it's about taking shortcuts to achieve things that you should have worked to achieve. So you can get things, you can get position, you can get power, you can even access magic, but you didn't work to achieve those things. You didn't do the mundane tasks that are necessary to build the internal infrastructure. This is what the nakshatra is about. Pure Jupiter, pure expansion, the ability to merge with anything, to have anything you want with no Saturn at all, no limitations. So with no limitations in ultimate possibility, who would you become? This nakshatra is also associated with mafia and ritual magic. Mafia first. Organized crime does very well financially because they don't have to abide by the rules that other people abide by. So when you don't have these rules in place, you have all opportunity for expansion. You can use violence, you can use extortion, you can use anything you want, and you can expand, you can grow, but you don't have any limits. I mean, legal limits, moral limits, ethical limits, you don't have any limits, so you can grow. The parallel with ritual magic is this: the attainment of things you didn't work for, the claiming of things that are not yours to claim because you didn't work for them. You can't handle them. The making of pacts to achieve things easily is the equivalent to making a deal with the devil. Usually this image conjures up being out in the desert, being alone, right? So it's this idea of there's nobody watching. You can be whatever you are. You can say whatever you want. It's just you. No one's there to correct you. No one's there to see you, judge you, or restrain you. Purvabhadrapada also has to do with technology. The nakshatra, being expansive, unrestrained, no boundaries, no parameters, it talks then about being consumed by and merging with and then becoming enslaved by distortions and illusions. In this case, we're talking about external sources telling us what we should do, how we should act, when we should be available, how we should present ourselves, what hours we do business, what's a suitable, you know, you get the idea. When is the last time you spent 2 days without your telephone? When's the last time you spent a week with no computer and it wasn't a really big deal? Look around your house. You probably have a sitting room, and most people have a television in that room. And not only do they have the television in that room, but the entire room is made around the television. It becomes an extension of you. You can usually see the television or hear the television from any room in the house. So it's always around you. And it's the same with the phone. It becomes an extension of your arm because you always have it in the hand, or very often have it in the hand. I bet right now, you know where your phone is. Even if you're not holding it watching this video, you know where your phone is. That's the point. We are merging with technology, we're becoming technology. Then it also comes to tell us about how we spend our time. So if somebody emails us, we're supposed to email right back. So for work, for other people, for relationships, for when we are available or not available, it alleviates us from having to make any rules for ourselves or any boundaries for ourselves, because this is the social convention. This is what people do. This is what's expected of us. So you give over your thinking to the thinking that some programmer has created. And so in essence, the programmer programs you. And this is what your life becomes about. It's a parallel to the guru, some external source telling you what to do. Jupiter is associated with the kidneys, with purification, and also the guru. And so here's where that comes into play. The guru is an external spiritual teacher who tells you what spiritual law is, how you are to obey it, what it's supposed to look like. But the trick is that you are using the parameters set from another external source to tell you when you're in bounds or out of bounds. And when you're building your soul, it doesn't work like that. That guru has to be you. the guru has to be internal, not external. So the purification part, the fire part, is the killing off of the guru, the killing off of those external parts that tell you how you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to do and what those parameters are, in order for you to build that structure within yourself, by yourself. Spoiler alert, here's the secret. There is no devil. The restraint, the devil made me do it. It's the same thing like, you know, before a wedding when men will go to strip clubs and what they always say is, oh, I didn't want to go, but I got dragged there. Tradition made me do it. Or, I didn't want to, but everybody else was. What, peer pressure made you do it? There is no temptation if you didn't want to do something in the first place. And that's the idea behind this image. You can take the chain off at any time. The chain is there for your convenience. The chain is there as an excuse for you to do what you want to do. So if you don't want to think for yourself, if you wanted to do some type of behavior, but were otherwise not able to do, the chain is your matter of convenience. I used to live in Miami, and the people who come to Miami, they act there like they would never act at home. If they're married, doesn't matter. If they don't do drugs at home, doesn't matter. If they, like, anything. So Miami is where people go, like, that's where the professional sinners go. We laugh at the people in Las Vegas, because if you really want to sin, you come to Miami. But the point is, you wouldn't even be tempted by any of that if you didn't actually want to do it. And you wouldn't do it at home where people were watching you because they would judge you, or because that's not what an upstanding person does. So the idea of you comes up against the real you. There is no devil. The devil is you, or the devil is not you. But that's the point. You have everything available to you. So how do you act? How do you act when nobody's watching? That's what you're really about. When you're building your soul, honestly, nobody's watching, nobody's keeping score. It's just you. If you stray, it's only you who knows that. What standards you use for yourself, only you know that. You can portray anything you want to the world. You can blindly adhere to rules. You can adhere to rules because it looks really good to other people. But the standard alone is yours. And the responsibility alone is yours. And that's the point of the nakshatra. Really, only one who's really paying attention is your soul. And the only one who knows the difference is your soul. So back to this idea about shortcuts. We think about making deals with the devil. It conjures up this idea of the temptation of Christ, being out alone in the wilderness. And it's this parallel of you're in the abyss. There's nobody watching. You can do anything you want. You can do anything you want. So what would you do? We see everywhere people who keep getting ahead by, like, they cut corners, they lie. Here's what makes it a little more difficult. So we can say straight up, if the devil appeared in front of us, no, we won't do that. You could just outright refuse somebody who you're in a conversation with because it presents itself that way. But the problem is that this concept doesn't present this way in real life. When you are asked to betray something that is of inner value to you, when you are asked to betray parts of your soul for the external comfort, it comes in forms that are personal to you. So it's not something you would outright refuse because you wouldn't outright recognize it. It comes with the soothing voice that what you're doing is right because the other person is wrong. It comes in the soothing voice that you're not really saying anything bad. All you have to do is not say anything. It comes in the voice of, you don't have to stand up for that person. She probably brought it on herself. It's really not your business. It comes in the form of, that's just the company policy. There's nothing it's ever going to change. There's nothing you can do about it. It comes in all the forms where we know we should act, that we know we should stand up, that we know we must say something. Not because it will change the other person, but by not saying something, it changes us. That's the intricacy of it. The other part of it is we think about making a deal in order to gain something. That's one end of it. But more so the case that isn't really talked about is what you're going to lose. And what you're going to lose might be your job that's toxic, but then you don't have an income. Your family that's toxic, but then you don't have a family. Your social standing, your reputation. But these are all things that are worldly imposed. And that's the difference here, is how we think we are supposed to act. What we merge with what we let ourselves become part of, what we over-identify with. And what we are over-identifying with, the structures, our political affiliations, our religions, our families, our occupations, these are all things that are attached to the ego because they are all impermanent. They're just for a while. They have nothing to do with our soul. What does have to do with our soul is how we act in this vehicle and how we come across as who we are and whether we do that or whether we betray that. And so what the nakshatra is about is in the face of you could do anything and nobody's watching you and nobody's there to correct you. The only one who knows the difference is you. And so that's the internal infrastructure when everything else has gone away. That's the only one who knows the difference. And so the point of the nakshatra is to burn away the impurities, to burn away all of the exteriors, the guru, the technology, all of the externally imposed identities that are non-essential to our path and that all they have served to do is show us what we are not. Cancers, sun, moon, and rising. The new moon is asking you to clear up things in relation to debt, to the past, to secrets, intimacy, large sums of money, eighth house things. So deep things. Congratulations, you get the prize this time. The eighth house is a very easy place to merge with because it's a Scorpio house, it's a water house, you're a water sign, and it's a deep place. So it's a place where when you start to think about the past, you can get lost in the past. When you have debt, you have enormous debt. When you have money, you also have enormous money. But this is about legacy, inheritance. So it's about what you do at a deep level and what you are passing on. So it's also related to secrets and secrets that we perpetuate. And what this new moon is asking you to do is look at where you have merged with the identities of, say, like your debt. Your money, your shame about money, your lack of money, all the money you have, right? So like, where have you identified with your finances to the point where now you identify with your finances as a source of identity or your secrets or where you've merged with your intimate partner to a place where you don't exist anymore. So it's asking you to look at where you've merged with these things. I mean, eighth house also has to do with stuff like astrology, occult sciences, like all the stuff I like. But when it becomes your identity, that's something to pay attention to because that is still an externally imposed identity. It could be something that you really like, but anything that we really like, we get really wrapped up in and it becomes an artificial identity. And so that's what the new moon is asking you to look at. Where have you merged with these things? And where do you need to now differentiate yourself? Where do you need to burn off these things you identify with, so you take them on as part of yourself? They're not part of you. So what have you merged with? How can you separate from it, burn off the impurities that have nothing to do with you, and you get back to just who you are? Now, Jupiter is looking to expand you in the seventh house. And your seventh house has to do with your committed partnerships, your close one-on-one relationships, your business partnerships, and who you are in public. So if you deal with these eighth house issues, what you release means that you've created space for benefits to come in for you and your spouse, maybe money to come for your spouse, maybe new contracts to come. If you clear up secrets from the eighth house, that allows you and your partner, you and your spouse, to have a better relationship. But anything you clear up in the deepness of the eighth house, you're allowing the blessings that are coming to you from Jupiter from the seventh house, and those will arrive next month. But for now it's time to clean up your eighth house. Unmerge with the identities, unmerge with the secrets, unmerge with the finance, unmerge with these things that you identify with. Even if you are working on trauma, sometimes trauma becomes your story. And I'm not minimizing people who work with trauma because I've done it myself. And I've also seen people who do that, and it does become their story, which means they're not getting through it. They're not working through it. That's become their home. That's who they are. They are their trauma. So it's stuff like this. Look at what you're working through. Look at your psychological issues. Like, you are not these things. You are experiencing these things, but you are not these things. And that's what the new moon is asking you to differentiate. This is another one of those moon cycles when everybody's talking about the Pisces new moon and how beautiful it is and how calming it is. And maybe that's not the way you're experiencing it. Another way of experiencing it is this is the final step of what's been going on since at least December. you've been going through, again, it's like it felt like you were underground and all of the earth was moving and all of the circumstances were moving. You're being forced to look at your relationships and the situations and the people in your life and who you are around. And now's the time. I heard it said, pick a lane. Who are you? And who's in your lane? Alternatively, who doesn't belong in your lane? There are all of these benefits of releasing, but I'm going to talk right now about the cost of holding on. There's, in conflict resolution, what's called positive peace and negative peace. Positive peace is when everything is as it should be, and there's natural flow, and the energy's right, and there's calmness, and there's happiness. It is how it should be. Negative peace is the absence of overt conflict. That means everything's going below the surface. There are tensions, there are things that are making you sick, there are things that are keeping you up at night, there are weird things going on with the relationships around you, there's all kinds of stuff that's wrong, but if somebody was watching, there's no fight, it's all internal. That's negative peace. So here, we're in a state of negative peace because we've been watching what's around us, and if you're on a spiritual path, your standards are different than other people's standards. So how you behave is going to be different, how you are energetically, what you do for yourself vibrationally, how you choose to spend your time, what you listen to, like, you know, what you nourish yourself with, what you stay away from. These are all different to people who are not on a spiritual path. And energetically, they don't mix. And they get to a point where they mix less and less, where it becomes beyond awkward. It becomes just uncomfortable. And then it becomes impossible. You just can't do it. Besides the nightmares, but like you just can't do it. It's not even like you go there and you're uncomfortable when you're in the room. You just can't even get in the car to go. You just can't do it anymore. But right before that, I'm going to talk now about bandwidth. Bandwidth is something that's talked about in narcissism, with narcissistic relationships. There were researchers at Princeton and MIT who were looking at bandwidth, which is your mental efficiency. And they're looking at when you are around certain people, how it drains your bandwidth. So think about when you don't sleep for a night and then you have to get up and perform. How well do you do? Nothing. You do awful. You're too tired. You can't do it. Then all you have to do is go to sleep and then you're back. Versus if you are around people who are depressive, who are negative, who are just all like energetically draining, they steal your bandwidth. It's the same with people who are toxic or who, when you think about getting into a conversation with them, all it does is give you a headache. You have to think about like, what can't I say? What's going to send them off the edge? What's going to completely wreck the relationship this time? Not because you've done anything, just because, like, it's not about you. It's about, like, it's that tedious. It's that tedious, and frankly, it's that fragile. So you're putting in all of this effort to wonder about how to tiptoe around this situation that's, it's dead. If it was in a good place, it wouldn't be that fragile. So you're tiptoeing around, you're walking on eggshells, trying to not have something fall apart that's long dead. But you're just trying to have it not fall apart. For them, they don't know the difference and they don't care. For you, this is enormously energetically draining. And so what happens is that you have fatigue, you have stress, all of this mental energy going into this direction that is not about your path, that is not about your work, and that has nothing to do with what you're supposed to be doing in this world. All it does is drain you. So the price of holding on is significant. Even if there's no overt conflict, the toll that it takes on you and the energy and direction that it takes away from where you're supposed to be going, that adds up. If ever you were to do a new moon ritual, this is the time. I would work with the Saturn, use a lot of lead. If you have lead items around your house, you can use a pencil, you can make a drawing. But I would write or draw the things that no longer belong in your life. And then that paper that you've used, burn it. Burn it for purification. This sounds simple, but symbolically what you are doing is telling the universe you are ready to release this. You are ready to release this, you put it into another form, let it go. In releasing it, what you're also saying is, I have cleared up all of this space for whatever blessings are coming to me. I am ready for the next step. I now have capacity to handle the bigger things that are coming to me as a result of the work that I've been doing.